program.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. Wow, what an audience. Welcome to our new educational series, What's Bugging You, First Fridays. My name is Alejandro Calixto. I'm the New York State IPM program leader. And on behalf of our team, we would like to thank you for joining us today. Please sit, relax, and enjoy these amazing presentations that we're starting today. We hope to see you in the next few months. More to come from the IPM program. Stay safe, stay happy, have a great weekend, and thank you again for joining us today.
Great, thank you, Alejandro. And I know that all of you are here because you really want to learn more about spotted lanternfly. So I want to introduce you to the person who is going to tell you more about spotted lanternfly. Brian Eshenaur is our greenhouse and ornamental crop specialist with New York State Integrated Pest Management. And he's also been leading our efforts on spotted lanternfly. So I'm going to turn it over to Brian, and he's going to share his screen and introduce you to this pest.
Thanks, Amara. Glad to be here for the first Friday. And hopefully you can see my screen there. Does that look good for everybody? I'm assuming it does. So
you are good, Brian.
Okay, great. All right. You know, we are talking about spotted lanternfly. It's been in the U.S. for a while now, but I want to see or hear how much you know about spotted lanternfly before we even get started. So I've got a poll question here. I've got two poll questions, and then we'll get into the content of this. So the first one here is, how much do you know about spotted lanternfly? Is it all new to you? Have you heard about it? Different levels here. So feel free to put that in, and then we're all going to see the results here. Great. Good number of you are participating in the poll. And whenever you're ready, Amar, you can show that.
Okay. Here's your 3-second warning if you wanted to vote. Put your votes in now.
Excellent. So just a few of you haven't heard much about it, but a lot of you have heard and are curious to learn more. No one classified themselves as an expert. And you know what? We're all learning about this in the U.S. So there's very few spotted lanternfly experts out there. But I'm happy to take you through this presentation today so we can learn more about it. But just one more question before we get started here. And we're going to put this question up. Is spotted lanternfly established within New York State already? Good. I see a good number of people chiming in here. This is one that, you know, we've been expecting it for a while. Is it here yet?
Here's your 3-second warning. I'm about to close the poll.
Yeah. So it is in three or four locations. It has established itself, and that's all new within the last year. So that happened in 2020 that it's been identified. We're going to take a look at a map later where it is, but this really heightens our concern about it in New York State. And we're going to talk about what we can do about this insect and managing it going forward. So let's get started here. Let's do a little bit of background on this insect. It is an invasive plant hopper. So, you know, it kind of looks like a moth to me, but it's a plant hopper. And we're going to talk about what that means and how that feeds. But it's native to China and Vietnam. Over there, it's not a big deal. There are natural predators that keep it in check. And that's the case with many of our invasive species. They are not invasive. They're not particularly a problem in their native lands. Anyway, in the U.S., it feeds over 70 plant species, and that number continues to grow. It's really not too picky on what it feeds upon. For us, grape, hops, apples are crop hosts that it can feed on. you're going to hear that really grapes are our primary concern because it really loves those. But even above those crop hosts, it really likes Tree of Heaven. In fact, up until a couple of years ago, we thought it might require Tree of Heaven to be able to reproduce. But now we know it just really likes that and does very well when it has access to Tree of Heaven. Here's just a few shots of that. You have certainly seen Tree of Heaven when you've been driving around because it is so widespread, but you might not have recognized it. Here are some shots that I took in the parking lot behind the office building that I work at. And you can see the seed heads that are still out there right now, even with the leaves off. There are male and female plants, and the female plants are still holding their seed heads now. And they produce a lot of seeds. And it's one reason that this plant is so prolific and invasive. The bark here in the forefront is not furrowed. It's never very thick or corky. To me, it kind of looks like cantaloupe skin, but we'll take a look here. There's another shot of the bark. It has compound leaves. So all these leaflets here make up a single leaf, and one leaf can be as long as 3 feet. That's a yardstick there. One characteristic that distinguishes the leaves of a spotted lanternfly, a lanthus tree from others are these appendages at the base. So this Tree of Heaven will have those appendages there that are circled. All right, there's an opportunity for you all to get involved in identifying spotted lanternfly and Tree of Heaven. If you're interested, we need volunteers to participate in this effort. And there's a training coming up in June. The registration opens in April. And this would be going to the website newyorkimapinvasives.org. And on there, you'll see a little icon with the spotted lanternfly that would give you a chance to participate and help inform how widespread is this Tree of Heaven, because likely that'll be the first place that spotted lanternfly is found in a new area that it goes to. So, you know, these spotted lanternflies are polka dotted. They have bright colored underwings. So we might think, you know, we're gonna see these pretty easily when they move into a new area, but they can be tricky. They're actually at a distance, a little bit camouflaged. Here's a shot I took of some spotted lanternfly on a red maple. This is in an area where for a couple of years, they only were on a lanthus tree, and then they moved to red maples after they had really established themselves. And this was in Pennsylvania. But I have another question for you here. How many spotted lanternfly do you see on that tree to the right? So this is a poll question. You have an opportunity to take a look there and count the number of spotted lanternfly. And then we have arrows. So I will be able to show you all of the spotted lanternfly that are on there. Right, people are weighing in, numbers are increasing.
Gonna give folks about 3 more seconds to get your guesses in.
Great, yeah, you gotta look closely there. Good, all right, so a couple of people saw 1, 2, 3, and 4, and some more than 4. Well, let me show you what I was seeing here. Oops. I counted 4. For those of you that counted more than 4, you'll have to let me know later where you found another one. But I think in this photo, we've got at least 4, but you can tell they're pretty camouflaged, you know? for this unusually patterned insect. So it does take a while to know what to look for. But this is why we're concerned about spotted lanternfly in New York, or one particularly concerning reason why, because they feed on grapes and they have caused vineyard loss in Pennsylvania. And we want to prevent that from happening in New York. So we're going to try to slow the spread. And we're working with grape growers, so they'll have techniques to be able to manage them. But as you know, grapes are an important part of New York State's agriculture economy. This map is from the New York State Wine and Grape Foundation. And I like it. It kind of looks like wine stains there on the map that really highlight the regions across New York State. And it's not just one area. You can see vineyards across various parts of New York. So it's an important part of the agriculture economy, with over 470 wineries, almost double that in grape farms, and a total economic impact of $6.6 billion. So with an insect like this, we really want to do everything we can to prevent it from causing an impact on that important industry in New York. Let's take a look at this insect and talk about how it feeds, how it impacts grapes and potentially trees in our own backyards. So here it is, the spotted lanternfly flipped upside down. And take a look at the center. Right here you can see this is how this insect feeds. It doesn't chew on the leaves. It uses this needle-like structure to go right through the bark and suck the juices out from the pipework of the tree. It does that with this piercing, sucking mouth part, and then out the backside, it excretes honeydew. And we're gonna show you that here. So we've got a little video, and you can see some of these insects are on the clusters of grapes. They're not feeding on the fruit itself. They are reaching in to the vascular tissue and sucking the juices out of the phloem there. In this shot, we're going to be seeing some of the honeydew that's coming out of the back end of the insects. And if we look at this spotted lanternfly here, we're going to see some there. Can you see that? That is honeydew that's coming out. So that insect has processed some of the sap that they sucked out of the vines, and they have bacteria in their gut that are utilizing that, transforming it to a food that they can use. And then this is basically a waste product that does have a lot of sugars in it, and that's called honeydew. And I was in Pennsylvania around a tree that had a lot of spotted lanternfly, and when they were actively feeding during the day, it felt like it was raining. And you may have seen a shot like this. This isn't typical, but it can occur. And it has occurred in some locations in Pennsylvania. They like to be together. They like to feed in aggregates like this. And so you can get a tree that is just covered in spotted lanternfly. And that can be alarming. But for most landscape trees, we see little impact in the overall health of the tree. But that honeydew is coming down, and that sticky material gets on hard surfaces, and then we can have this mold, this sooty mold grow on that. And that's what you see here. This lower step was power washed, and the upper two still have the honeydew and sooty mold on them. I have a picture of a honeybee and a yellow jacket here, because they are attracted to the honeydew, and so you may see greater numbers around there. And there is even some experiences in Pennsylvania where this insect is widespread of honey tasting like the honeydew that comes out. So the the bees, instead of going to flowers for their nectar, are going to the honeydew and making honey out of that. Some honey producers are even marketing spotted lanternfly honey. They say it has an earthy flavor. So I was talking about this several months ago, and somebody said, oh, my nephew has a way to deal with this. He lives in Pennsylvania. I was down visiting him in 2019. And here she sent me this picture of him with a shop vac. And if you can't tell there, I expanded that image. Yeah, he's sucking them off of his maple tree there with a shop vac. So this does happen, but fortunately, it's rare for us to see dieback on the maple trees that they're accumulating on. So they are a nuisance, but they don't threaten the tree themselves. Let's take a look at the life cycle of these. We've been talking a lot about the adults here, but right now, all the spotted lanternfly in the U.S. are in these egg masses. They all died with the first hard freeze. Only the eggs survive. And then with some warmth in later May and June, those eggs hatch. And the first instars look like a small tick that is spotted with some white spots. They continue to grow and molt. And eventually in the summer, they reach a stage where they have a red coloration to them. And then the final molt, they turn into the recognizable spotted lanternfly. So this does not occur until late July or September. And then they spend from September up until that hard freeze, and that might be in December, feeding as adults and then laying eggs to continue the cycle. It's these eggs that really concern us because they can be a source of spread. These can travel long distances and survive very cold temperatures. Here we can see the egg masses. They start out in a light color when they're first laid by the female. And then they age to this more brownish tan putty color that blends in pretty nicely with bark. And you can see here the eggs in a long chain with the a mud like putty material that the female puts over most of them. She might have been disturbed here and didn't get a chance to finish the job. And they can survive even unexposed, but they're more vulnerable in that way. I have these shots here to remind all of us that they can lay eggs on anything. It's not just tree bark. Here's one of those foldable chairs that was laid down. These were laid on the underside of that. And that's what makes it tricky, because you have to lift things up to look at where those egg masses were. But we could see if we were moving or for whatever reason, taking that chair with us to an event outside of the quarantined area or the area where it is located, we could potentially be moving this insect. And with warm weather, they could hatch in a new place. And with so many, you could have a mating population and start a new outlying colony. So that's one place. Also, they seem to like things that feel like bark to them, like rusty metal. They'll be on stakes like this. Again, if it's leaning over, it'll be kind of on the underside. And it can be on just about anything where we could see these. So it's really important if you're in an area, particularly in Pennsylvania and now in some spots in New York State, where spotted lanternfly is located, to inspect anything that's moving, because it is believed that it arrived in the U.S. on stone that came from Korea, where it's also invasive. All right. On their own, those adults can only move for about 3 to 4 miles a year. That's why we're really concerned about moving the adults and those egg masses. And I'm pretty sure that's how it has spread so far so quickly. Really important to check anything that you're moving outside of an area where spotted lanternfly is currently located. here is where it got started in Berks County, Pennsylvania, and it has spread since then. This is a map we maintain at the New York State IPM program. And this is the current spread. We continually update this as new reports come in from throughout the Northeast. And you can see it was just a few weeks ago where we had our last edition, but it was in 2020 where it was identified the first infestation in New York was noted on Staten Island. It spread pretty much through Staten Island now. There's a couple of boroughs in the New York City area that may have some small populations. And then there are some also small populations in Orange and Rockland counties. And then one right here in the Finger Lakes that is a very small population. Maybe there's a possibility that that could be eradicated. We could take that off the map. But for right now, that infestation near Ithaca is there. And it's one we're really concerned about because of the Finger Lakes wine industry. Of course, we have a pretty big industry in the Hudson Valley and on Long Island. So all of those areas, in addition to Western New York, are something we're watching for. So some spotted lanternfly tips. If you're visiting an area where spotted lanternfly is located, really inspect all items. Inspect your car. It could land on you. When we're in an area in Pennsylvania, we really have to be careful because we can have those adults just pop in with us. And so we want to check very carefully before we leave. And here is something that in the coming growing season, and as we move forward, if you see it, report it. On your right is a place where you can go to report it. This is at the New York State IPM website that has all the spotted lanternfly information. You can see this is where the map is. This is where most people enter our website to look for spotted lanternfly. You can put in a search engine, New York State IPM spotted lanternfly. This will be right at the top. And if you click on this area here to report it, it will go to a portal. You'll enter some information about your location. There's a place to upload pictures if you have them. And that's really important to do, as well as your contact information. You hit submit, you get an automatic reply to let you know that it was received. It's reviewed with some specialists at our New York State Ag and Markets, and they'll get back to you on that. So please, anything that looks suspicious, send that on to them. We really want that. That's going to help us stop the spread at this point. And then if you are in an area where they develop and the populations increase over the years, it's important not to panic and remember that these insects, even though they have that long needle-like structure, they don't bite us. They don't sting. And they really don't cause damage to our landscape plants, although they can be a nuisance. And here's a shot that from Pennsylvania where they have been a nuisance. This restaurant actually closed these entrances because the spotted lanternflies had accumulated there. Almost looks like they're going in there and maybe, they have a taste for burritos, but we don't have any confirmation on that. Anyway, it has caused concern in Pennsylvania. We want to just get good information out so that you don't need to call 911 to report that as had occurred in Pennsylvania. All right, last question here as we wrap up. What should you do if you believe you've found a spotted lanternfly? So this is a poll we're going to launch. And if you would go ahead and answer that. I see the answers are coming in. This is good.
I'll give folks another couple seconds to answer before I close the poll.
Okay, there it is. You got it. You know, stop it. You might want to do that, but because it's new to New York, we want you to take a picture of it before you stop it and report that. We want to know every place it is in New York State at this point. And we're not going to treat it with pesticides yet. But report it. Most of you got that. You know, if you insist on taking a selfie and posting it to social media, somebody did their first report it. All right. So really that wraps up. I think we're just about out of time. I don't want to go over. I just want to let you know that we're doing a lot with this. Pennsylvania has been great. You know, they were saddled with receiving this insect or, you know, having it come there first. They're sharing a lot of great information with us. We're really grateful to have that. And we're doing some of our own work here throughout New York State with our New York State IPM program, the entomology department at Cornell, pesticide education management program, and Cornell Extension, Northeastern IPM, all doing some work. There's some hope for some biocontrol that'll take place. The image on the right is a spotted lanternfly that's affected with a fungus. But if we have time for questions, we can handle a few of those.
Yes, thank you, Brian, so much. I'm going to go ahead and launch one final poll, which you can answer, which folks can answer while Brian is addressing a few questions. So some questions that came into the chat while you were speaking. Someone wanted to know, a few people asked either about controlling spotted lanternfly organically or with other pesticides. Brian, where could they go to learn more about how to control pests, maybe on like a farm setting?
Yeah, well, for a farm setting or home setting, both at our New York State IPM website, we just put up the list of pesticides that are available. It's relatively easy to control this insect with pesticides, but you know, we want that to only be done when necessary. So there are a list of those that could be used in a home situation. There's very few that have plant hoppers on the label, but there are a few. We expect there will be more in the future. We'd encourage you to use those, not home remedies. That's actually not legal to use. So if necessary, use that. Check our website. We're gonna be updating that as more products become available for us in New York. And for grape growers, we have quite an extensive list along with the efficacy data from Pennsylvania. They're both there. If you are on the right side of the webpage, there's right at the top our pesticide list. There are also traps. We anticipate learning more about the traps as it becomes more prevalent in New York, and we'll have a lot of information about that on our website as well. Some of them are beginning to be commercialized.
Great. I'm going to ask you one more question. For those who have questions in the chat that we don't get to address today, I think we're going to look into a way to go through these questions and maybe post some frequently asked questions and answers on the website where you registered for this event. But my last question for you today, Brian, is someone is saying that for gypsy moth eggs, they scrape the eggs and pound them. Is that a good way to deal with spotted lanternfly eggs if you have them on trees?
Absolutely. If you take like a Ziploc type bag and take a card, like a credit card. We even have spotted lanternfly scraper cards. You can easily scrape those into a bag. If you have a little rubbing alcohol in there, they'll be killed once they're in the bag. So it's a great technique to remove them. Unfortunately though, we found out that about 80 to 90% of them, if it's on a tree, are in the upper canopy. So they're not gonna be easy to reach. And so you can certainly kill those, but just know that there's probably other eggs that are up higher that you're not going to be able to reach.
Great, thank you. I know that there are some other questions that we didn't get to. I would encourage you to go to the New York State IPM Spotted Lanternfly site. There's a lot of answers to your questions there, a lot of resources, and we will save the chat and we will pull out some additional questions and add them to the website so that you can get those answers as well. So with that being said, let me pull up my notes, make sure I'm not forgetting anything here at the end of this meeting. We really do appreciate all of you participating. Thank you so much, Brian, for sharing information about spotted lanternfly. Thank you all of us for joining us today. You can register for future events. So our next event is going to be on April 2nd. They'll always be the first Fridays at noon. Our next event will be talking about dealing with springtime ants. We're hoping it will feel more like spring in April. And we're gonna have some tips for you on dealing with springtime ants in April. So you can register through the same link that you used to register for today's meeting. We would encourage you to, if you enjoyed this session, to share it with your friends on social media, with your community groups. If you know of others who would be interested in this, please share this information with them. And once we get the captions edited and all taken care of, we will be posting this video on YouTube as well. So thank you all again and have a great afternoon, everyone.
Thank you.